with things that people don't know who's who. But, so I'm Aiden. yeah, I most recently worked at Intel. I still get paid by Intel, but I don't really work for them anymore. You might find out why in this speech.
And I'm Moof. I actually don't work at Marmoset Music anymore. I have my last day on Friday, and I start a new gig at New Relic on Monday as a software engineer. So I'm excited about that. I want to open by telling you a quick story. At a previous job at a tech company, I had a high-up person in the company, an executive, who pulled me into his office, and he said he wanted an update on a project I was working on. During the conversation, he kind of slipped and called me the name of the other East Asian masculine person in the office. And I kind of grimaced, and he sort of saw me, and he realized what happened. It got real awkward for a second. And he apologized, and then we kind of moved on. And on the bus home that day, I just like was like, ugh, another one of these microaggression moments. You know, they just really stack up. And I posted about it on Facebook. I was like reaching out to my friends from my campaign social justice background. They were all great and supportive. And the next day, I was in a meeting, and I got pulled out of the meeting to step into this other room where they had the person this had happened with, and the HR person. And can you guess what happened next? Come on, I know this happened to somebody else. Right, I got in trouble for calling a coworker racist. Yeah, has that happened to you before? Yeah, I hear some groans. So unfortunately, this is a really common thing. So we just wanted to share a little bit about our experiences being East Asian in tech, and also being trans masculine. I see some of you Asian folks out there. Hello. Hi. I see trans folks here. Hello. Hi. And lots of other beautiful queer and trans people of color here. We see you.
Yeah, so I basically just kind of want to motivate why we're here talking, to kind of follow up on what Moof said. Basically, Moof and I met through Slack. I started talking to Moof because I knew not a single other person who was trans masculine and East Asian. So I don't really like Moof, but we only have that in common. That's the only reason why we're friends. But really, we wanted to talk about our experiences in tech because we have never heard anybody else really talk about it. It's a very kind of lonely intersection of identities. I think that there's interesting things about it, and hopefully everybody in the audience has something that they can kind of take away from it and that they find interesting.
So the interactive part of this is we wanted to encourage folks in the audience to think about what could have been done differently in these situations. So as a little warm up, think about the story I just told. Let's see if we can get three ideas on something that could have been done differently. So I know this is the very first time doing something interactive all day. Let's hear some other voices. Yeah, we've got one over here.
All right. I think that first initial moment when that had happened to you, when that thing was awkward, to just had a moment, I mean, it was great that he apologized, but maybe just to sort of have an ask question, like how that made you feel, if there's anything that he could have done differently, to kind of just nip, like just really get that, capture that moment for what that was and see if there was, I mean, I would have loved for him to be like, is this something that happens to you regularly? Is this something we can address? Is this systematic? And just kind of using any opportunity to try to advance some progress, so. Anybody else?
Yes.
So it seems like there's an opportunity for the HR people to say, like, well, what could you suggest we do to address this problem that this person keeps, like, lumping you in with somebody else?
All right, one more?
Kind of like to turn it around and make it a little easier on the other people, and that is I typically will look at them and say, I couldn't help but notice you just did X. Is there anything I can do to make it easier for you the next time?
Cool. Thank you, everybody. That was a great warm-up. And I did want to add, you know, a lot of people are probably right now thinking about the person I had the interaction with or the HR person who I interacted with the next day. But there were also a lot of other people in the company who maybe could have been involved or done something differently. So I wasn't friends with this person on Facebook. So how did he find out, right? I was only friends with like three or four people from my workplace. So that means that they tattled on me, right? That means somebody reached out to him and was like, hey, we've said this thing on Facebook, they called you racist, which is not what I said anyway, but that's how people hear it, right? So think about, you know, you might not be directly in a situation like this, but if you hear of something going on, you gotta be there for your friend. A, don't tattle, and B, maybe check in with them, because nobody checked in with me to see if I was okay. They just all, you know, went right to the boss person and told them what was going on, so.
Okay. I'm actually gonna switch gears and talk about my individual experience, in particular, my first job out of college. So I started at Intel. I moved to Portland right out of my undergrad. I was about a year into my medical transition. It was my first job ever being seen as a man. And so that kind of, it was a shock when I first started my job, and immediately I was being involved in these conversations I had never heard before as a woman. And I had interned before, I'd worked in tech before, but always seen as a woman. It was so shocking, you know, people, you know, cis white men were very openly talking about women. It started off with just undermining women's abilities within the workplace, you know, questioning their competency as employees, as coworkers, and then it quickly turned into like sexualizing comments about women and their bodies. And that was like my first job in tech out of college, and that was pretty horrible. And about 2 weeks later, these guys that I barely knew, they started making these transphobic jokes about Caitlyn Jenner. And so pretty much at the point I couldn't take it anymore, and you know, I pushed back on them. And I basically asked them to stop, and after that, every time things came up, I asked them to stop. And after that, I feel like I had essentially outed myself, not even as being trans or being queer, just as someone that was not going to put up with this, right? And so after that, I started getting comments about me being too liberal. and then after that, comments started about me being effeminate. Some guy came up and showed me a photo of like a meme about Asian people having small penises. Let me see, at one time I walked into work and there was a note on my desk with a pair of scissors that said, cut your hair. That was fun to come into work too. So obviously as this happened, I started becoming more withdrawn. I was having trouble focusing at work. I wasn't socializing with anybody. But the incredible thing was that even as this was all happening, there were even physical aggressions happening. I was once picked up, like put up against the wall. I was dragged around by my sweater once. But all this time I went home and sometimes I didn't even tell my partner about it. I didn't tell my friends about it. I would switch back and forth cognitively between, you know, thinking that this was just the way that men work and that this was just something I didn't know about. And even if that is the case, I didn't think that there was anything wrong. I thought I was overreacting. And it wasn't actually until I was at a restaurant and I had kind of instinctively brought one of my coworkers along that he witnessed one of the guys like slap me really hard on the back. And after that, he like pulled me aside and was like, "What is happening? Like, how did you laugh that off? Has this been happening a lot?" And it really wasn't until that moment where someone who I felt was like privileged, and he was a white cis straight guy who had just happened to see it, until he was like, "This is wrong, and you shouldn't have to put up with this." It wasn't until someone else told me that it wasn't okay that I actually started slowly talking to HR about it. And I was very lucky that that Intel HR did take it seriously. They pulled me out of the organization. I got a new job within the company. But obviously, it was a very traumatic introduction to what it feels like to be seen as different in the workplace. I think I want to actually say a couple of takeaways that I kind of learned myself from this, and what I think that could have been done better in the future, and how people can help in these situations. So I think the first thing is that we struggle a lot with you know, right now there's a lot of talk about how to take allyship beyond being performative, right? How do you actually make an impact? How do you actually help people? And I think this is a really great example of it in a very nuanced way. A lot of marginalized folks don't know how they're supposed to be treated, right? They don't know what's right and what's wrong sometimes, because a lot of people are socialized into thinking that this sort of misbehavior is okay. So it was really important in that moment when I had a lot of my white coworkers validate me and tell me that it was okay to be to feel like I've been bullied, right? So I think that's one big thing, is just being more aware about people that are marginalized around you, right? And being more careful with them and being more caring towards them. And a second thing that I think is interesting that you may not know is that I think a lot of this had to do with the way that other East Asian people were behaving in the workplace. After that, I realized that, you know, there were like a ton of Asian people laughing at racial jokes, tons of Asian people laughing at homophobic jokes, generally being okay with the way that white people were talking to them about other people of color or about other marginalized groups that they weren't part of. And what we need to realize, especially, you know, working at Intel, there are a ton of Asian people at Intel, and Asian people play a big part in the way that tech culture looks today. And what we need to do is make sure that we use our numbers well, and we make sure that tech is not a place where white supremacy goes and challenged, right? So yeah, I think those are the two things that I'd like to share with y'all. And I'll let move to you.
Awesome. So are there any other takeaways from the audience? We wanted to make sure to create some space to maybe hear from two or three more folks. More questions, I guess.
I'm really sorry that happened to you. Did your manager see what was happening and take any steps to stop it, or was he or she oblivious to it?
It was a really small team, and everybody was friends with each other outside of work. So yeah, these were like guys that went out drinking together after work, and it was very obvious that this is a socially accepted behavior.
That was just one area. You know, I wish the burden hadn't been all on you to eventually take it to HR. I wish your manager had been more proactive in setting that tone for the team and stopping it.
Same.
I have a question that I was actually asked when I was presenting at a Women of Color tech event. Someone asked me, like, how do you deal with discrimination at work, and I don't have a job. I don't believe to. So how do you find support, you know, especially at a huge corporation like Intel? Are you in a better spot now, and how do you find support for dealing with this stuff?
Yeah, that's actually a wonderful question. I would say the biggest thing that I changed, so I did end up staying at Intel and moving to another group. The biggest thing that I actually figured out was, you know, I was obviously stealth coming into work, and I'm still semi-stealth, but I realized that one of the biggest forms of protection is to be open about who I am, and just kind of subtle ways, right? I used to try to mask my personality and basically never talk in situations where things could be controversial, where people could kind of even figure out what kind of person I was, right? But when I took my new job, like, the first thing I said was, like, I made, like, a Trump joke, and I, like, you know, I put it out there that I have, you know, I have trans friends, I have gay friends, I would just slip things into conversation. And, you know, the fact of the matter is I don't really care what people on my team have, what their opinions are, you know, in their private lives. They're horrible people everywhere, and we'll always encounter them. But I think in terms of protecting yourself, one good way is to use sort of corporate guidelines to your advantage, right, at these big companies. People know what they can and what they can't say. And if you give them an inch, they're going to take a mile, right? So what I ended up doing was just being very open about, you know, I would call myself like a raging liberal, like talk about my gay friends all the time. And this is all without having to come out at all, right? And actually, it increased my influence within my team. You know, people would come to me and ask me about social issues. I was able to like help other men behave a little bit better, and that's been a really nice outcome out of all of this.
I think we're running out of time, so I just want to.
That was
the 1 minute. Yeah. Okay, I just want to close with one other thought. You know, earlier I was addressing the other Asian folks in the room. And I wanted to follow up on what Aiden said about that we have numbers in tech. You know, this whole larger conversation about diversity in tech, I think a lot of people kind of lump Asian people in with white people. And I just wanted, especially to the other Asian folks, but everyone else too, I just want to encourage you to keep your eyes open, because I think what happens in that intersection is that companies use the model minority myth, and they try to lump Asian folks in with other people of color, black and brown folks, and then use those numbers to boost their diversity statistics. That's not cool. It masks the real anti-black racism that's happening in our companies. And I also want folks to be aware, like I recently was invited to kind of step up in leadership, and I would be the first person of color to do that. And that's not cool either, because it also does this divide and conquer thing where it's like, oh, look, this Asian person can do it, and it sets me apart from black and brown folks in the company, too. So I just want folks to, you know, keep your eyes open, always watch out in these larger conversations about diversity and inclusion for how East Asian folks in particular are being used as a wedge, and say no if it's happening to you.
Thank you so much.